Hello, everybody. We're broadcasting. Anyway, thank you. Hello, everybody. Welcome to yet another edition of Paradigm Shift, an educational comedy. And me, Dave, is here with Richard, as usual. And we have Timothy, a.k.a. Tevo77777, a.k.a. a lot of other things. And we are here to discuss art, so I am going to activate the screen share mode. Here is the infinite Google loop of infinity, and we're going to minimize that. And here is the profile, Tevo77777 on DeviantArt.
I actually got that nickname from camp. It's supposed to be T-I-V-O, but I didn't want to get sued, so it became T-E-V-O. Because I record everything and I play it back.
Okay, so should I be clicking on featured or on all?
Just click, you know, the little pictures on the side, the gallery folders. Just you can do that if you want.
So your art focus appears to be guns and military equipment and things of that nature.
Well, I also do poems and I also do stories and maps. But most of my poems, I just complain about people I come into contact with.
Yeah. So I guess we can skip the Grumpy Kitty segment and go into the visuals. Come on, my browser. There we go. So I'm guessing improved real-life guns. So you're taking specifications from actual weaponry.
That's an actual design.
And adding to them what you feel is an improvement.
It's called a PTR-32. I renamed it. Yeah, it's an actual thing that H&K tried to sell, but they couldn't get anyone to buy it. It's a G3 that's running 7.62x39. The original guy who made the design, his name is Dalt TT. I took the design and I fit inside the AK mag, and then I shaded the design because his designs are done in like black and white and gray. He doesn't have a lot of colors to them.
Yeah. Rich should probably be better with assisting me in conducting this because he knows a lot about the gun stuff, and I know two things about the gun stuff. The first thing is Jack, and the second thing is shit.
Well, it looks like you took a HK...
G3.
Yeah, an HK G3, slapped a AK magazine on it, and called it golden. I actually kind of like it.
It's actually
because number one, you've got the fluted upper receiver on it, which is actually, you know, based off of the original
HK-33. That's what I used.
Well, yeah, I see what you used. I'm just saying it's based off of the Garrot 06 and 06H rifles. Those were some of the very first rifles that they actually used the design to flute the brass. And, you know, some of the designers from the Garrot 06 rifles actually went to what became modern Heckler & Koch, but you basically took the reliability of an HK and kind of meshed it with it.
Oh, you mean the Spanish design, the early Spanish design? Okay. So,
What software do you use to make these?
Paint. Microsoft Paint.
That's pretty good for paint.
I was about to say, I'm sorry. That must be torture.
No, it's I've used things like GIMP and paint.net, but I have a hard time with them because it requires more work.
This is like the best I can do with paint. It's just boom, 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 and boom. I mean, that's pretty much it. Bang, bang, bang.
I think William Black knows what the best is you can do with paint. But that aside, GIMP is actually pretty easy for me. I mean, it has a lot to it. So at first, it can provide the illusion of difficulty, but each of its components are really not all that difficult. It's just a lot to learn, and unfortunately, a lot of people seem to associate a lot with hard, almost like the concept of a grain of sand is not hard at all. And imagine thinking that, oh my God, there's so many grains of sand on the beach. I can't look at the beach. My brain is imploding. It's so hard. It's so much. You know, when in actuality, okay, just look at the beach. It's a fucking beach.
Well, so, well the weird thing is that, like, GIMP and Paint.net, they have a lot more features, and they can do much better art, but the problem is that making changes takes more time, because the software is designed to be very, very specific. Like, if you use the paint bucket, it makes the entire thing black. It doesn't make one thing or one color black. It makes the whole thing black. So you have to click one button to have the selector. Then you have to select a specific color. Then you have to make sure that you selected the correct color. Then you have to change the color. Then you have to do, like, three other things, and then you can turn all the red stuff black. You can do that in Paint in, like, 3 seconds, which is why I prefer Paint. I also use Paint.net to make backgrounds different and have layers and all that stuff.
Well, then I guess you haven't discovered the Select by Color feature, to where if you want to change one color to another, you just select by color. It highlights everything of that color, then you select the color you want to fill it in with, edit, fill with color, boom, done, which is, you know, a really simple thing. Boom, done. You just apparently didn't know about that tool.
Mm.
So again, it's not a matter of difficulty, it's a matter of the illusion of difficulty.
Yeah. Richard, do you know where you get your wood textures from?
Oh, when I do use wood, the thing is, with wood and Pimp My Gun, it's really, really time-consuming to make, and if you really get detailed with it, it can cause your machine to lag like a motherfucker. Generally get my wood, generally, you know, if I'm going to be using wood, really good, fine wood texture grains. I get it from, like, I'm looking at one of his works right here, Shockwave. He generally does pretty good wood texturing.
Yeah.
Yeah, and if the ladies don't want to get their wood from Pimp My Gun, they can always get wood from Rich.
Okay. So, is it Dave?
Fine. Don't laugh then, Richard.
It's Dave, right?
Yes, it's Dave. What's up?
Okay. Do you see the two little guns on the side of your thing surrounded by poems?
Yes, I do.
Can you click those?
No, I absolutely refuse.
Okay, so this is my last design. This is kind of a weird design. This is literally me doing a magazine conversion for two AKs, and I swapped out the stock. I just wanted to see what would happen. It's gotten some pretty positive feedback.
The real problem I'm noticing with this AK design is the stock on there. Number one, you'd have to get a trunnion adapter on the rear stock, so that way that in all reality, that stock would fall right off.
Probably, yeah.
So you'd want to have, like, a rear trunnion adapter, so that way that stock could then... The only problem with those stocks is those are collapsible stocks, and the only way you'd be able to really be able to use it is if, you know, you had it, like, kind of slanted to one side. But
that's what they do for the MP5, yeah. The stock, like, slides like this into on the side of the gun.
Yeah. Yeah, you can't really do that on an AK, I've learned. It's kind of...
it's too fat.
If you really want to do a collapsible stock, I made the Tate Arms AK Commando, which is kind of something similar. And I just took, like, a basic AR stock, and I got the AK trunnion adapter, so that way it would fit to, like, an AR-style buffer tube. That's really kind of, if you're wanting to do something that would actually work, that's what would work. Now, as for the magazine, you took an MP5 magazine, which they have done that. That is a modification that does actually exist. It's known as the... AK-9, or 9mm AK variant. They've actually developed such a design, and, you know, they've experimented with it. So that does, in fact, exist. It's a very real design. Do like the grip, but the only thing I can really say that you could work on or change is the stock, because, you know.
Just a word of advice about the AK-9 that fires 9x39, not 9x19.
Okay. Well, it's either 9x39 or 9x18 Makarov, which is...
I know the Bizen can fire 9x19. I know it takes 9x19 mags or 9x19
rounds. Well, I've seen AKs that can fire 9mm Parabellum. I've literally seen AKs that shoot 9mm. Hmm. You know, so
maybe they're conversions.
I didn't know there was such a caliber as 9x39, but I'm pretty sure that there is. I've seen AKs out there, 9mm para AKs that shoot 9x19 Parabellum ammunition, 9mm.
So. Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So can I go into my inspiration? Is that okay?
Yeah, you can do whatever. Okay. We're featuring your profile and your stuff, so it's your lead that we're taking here.
Okay, so can you go back to my page and then go back to my gallery and then go inside the folder that's labeled it's the one at the top. So inside my profile, inside my gallery, top folder. It's labeled JG. It's labeled JG, Junior General. Okay, so I have a certain way of doing things. I know people don't take very small pixely art seriously, but I like it because it allows me to write better. Because each of these different images, they're a different faction, or they're a section of a faction. So some of these are terrorist groups, some of these are mercenaries, some of these are nations, and some of these are players I work with, and some of these are myself. So I'm kind of a big, serious writer, and I'm a sucker for storyline.
What is this, like Rise of, or not Rise of, like, what's that game you guys play? What's
Nation States.
Nation States, is that what this is for?
Yes. But I've given Nation States money, it's a good site, my place. Sorry that I accidentally added you guys, I was adding a lot of people. On my list are tank people, so.
Where am I going?
Oh, just do your thing, scroll up and down, you know, look at stuff or whatever. But basically, I needed this to be here.
Is there anyone you want to focus on or talk about? Or
well, yeah. Okay, so my inspiration for, like, almost all art is the idea that when I was in high school, I read 1984, and I was working on this nation. And I worked on this nation before I even read 1984, or maybe after I had read only half of it. And the way I started making the whole setting was I wanted to make a dystopia that wasn't a bad place to live. I wanted to make a place very much like a dystopia, but like all the little things were changed so that it became a nice enough place that people would actually immigrate there.
So you wanted to make a complete contradiction that can't exist in reality?
No. Because, okay, have you ever played Bioshock?
No.
Okay, Bioshock has two different totalitarian states. Neither one of them can exist because the limits of science and money and society. So most books that are about a totalitarian state or dystopian state, they're that way. They're scientifically impossible because too many things go wrong. I kind of created a sort of opposite of that, but it's more realistic. So I said, what if I could put cameras on every single street, and what if I could have every single phone be tapped, but there was a reason for it? There was a legitimate reason for it. And what if people moved to this country because they wanted their phones to be tapped? And that's the setting I created.
And that would require a society that is immune from abuse of such things, which there's really no such thing.
Well, yeah, it's true. A lot of the nations that are nation states don't really couldn't exist in real life. Like one of the nations, it's illegal to wear clothing.
Nation states is weird like that.
It is weird.
I have my nation right here, the United Federation of Planetary Systems. Yeah, it's the United Federation of Planets, but the United Federation of Planets was already some deactive nation that it wouldn't let me take that name, so I just coined my own name, and I've been doing my own thing ever since. I am in the Coalition of Democratic Nations. I mess around with it, you know, now and then. It's kind of fun. I've got my own little laws and things of that nature.
I think Katarina would love living in a place where it's illegal to wear clothing.
Yeah, probably.
So,
but anyway, my government, you know, it's three branches of government, checks and balances. It's like, you know, the United Federation of Planets, you know, taking the U.S. governmental system or the original foundation of it and kind of expanding it in something much bigger. Got all these different military branch descriptions, stuff like that. So, anyway.
So, what ended up happening was once I created the setting, I needed to have an explanation for why the people were like that and why they were comfortable being that way. And the thing was, it's technically two countries now. It's Dupio Giudice, which translates into dual causes, order, and liberty. They want to have complete order and almost complete liberty, like a balance. So a lot of the designs I make are actually what's called kit bashing. I take old designs that work or don't work, and I fiddle around with them. I put stuff inside of them. That's what I do. That's another piece of art I did. I just did that just to do it. I took a B1 Baldroid and I fused B2 Super Baldroid parts into it to see if it could be done. It looks pretty reasonable. It could look better. The first thing I did was I made the whole body stronger so it could take more of a beating. But the head was kind of flimsy. Something I do. I kind of fuse stuff together. I'm like a guy who like welds things together that don't belong together. I'm like a mad scientist. So the reason why Dupio Giudice and Vadia, they're basically like the same people, just in different countries, because they're so far apart that they can't govern each other. Their historical background is suffering and war and constantly being invaded and constantly almost being enslaved. So it's formed this very... how do I explain this? In the real world... women got the right to vote, and they started to see like actual civil rights sometime after World War I and World War II, when they had been working in the factories to make weapons. And black people started to get their rights kind of around the same time, after they had been in the Civil War, after they'd worked in the factories during World War I and World War II, and after they served in parts of Korea and parts of Vietnam. So what I noticed was a connection between people who work in factories or fight on the front lines, they eventually get political power. They eventually become citizens. So what ended up happening in Vadia was Vadia was so desperate for work and was so desperate for weapons all the time that it became a constant requirement that women be ready to work in the factories. They could not be a society where women were pregnant and barefoot. They wouldn't survive that way. They had to have them in the factories or everybody would die. That's what it became. So during the 1800s and 1900s, Vadia would constantly have all their men conscripted and all their women would be stuck in the factory, and that's what they had to do to survive. And because of that, Vadia began to gain a lot of respect for women, and it kind of shifted that way. The reason why Vadia could never really be racist was because Vadia couldn't oppress people. They needed them to be on the front lines to be soldiers. So basically, long story short, is that Vadia was a country that was so constantly at war and constantly under threat that they could not be an oppressive society.
They're forced to get along.
They're forced to get along.
Mutual survival.
The concept was any person who is of benefit to the military deserves rights. And because women were in the factories, they deserved rights. And because minorities were on the front line, they deserved rights. And because the young did the fighting, they deserved rights. And that's just how it worked out. And then what happened was...
Because the old used to work in the factories and do the fighting, they deserved rights.
But what ended up happening was society became very democratic, but also became very authoritarian. Because the military became society, because whatever decision would benefit the military would keep society alive and would prevent them from being destroyed, enslaved, or conquered. So people were really, really willing to give up civil rights, but the problem was, since everybody had been in the military became everybody, so it became very democratic. It was really strange. And then because the country became so paranoid, it not only saw enemies on the outside, but saw enemies inside itself. So, and also, they've had problems with cultic terrorist groups and whatnot. So the country basically has this policy where almost every single man has a person, like a best friend, and their specific job is to shoot you if you become a cultist. That's their job. The country's really paranoid. Every single person is afraid that they could potentially become the enemy, that they could be converted, that they could be brainwashed, that the devil could crawl inside of them. So a lot of imagery that's on the propaganda posters or whatever, it pictures people sacrificing themselves for each other, but it also pictures them committing suicide when they think they're being turned. So there's been a couple cases in the storyline where people are being possessed, and right before they get turned over, they kill themselves. So it's a really weird setting. That's basically what I ended up with. It's a really dark setting, and people are just trying to get by. And Vadi has been inspired by a lot of different countries.
That sounds like a globalist wet dream.
Kinda. Vadia exists in nation states, and nation states is a place full of oppression, of slavery, of violence, of genocidal religious warfare. And Vadians are extremely compassionate people. When they see a person being hurt, they feel like they are being harmed. So what ended up happening was when the country was finally safe and they defeated all their enemies, they found out about the outside world and how bad it was, and they became so angry that they basically just started a series of wars of liberation. And that's the setting. The country went from really, really poor to really, really rich because they began to sell weapons to all their allies. Well, the country has been having some economic woes because they're having a hard time understanding a global economy because there's such an isolationist power. But what's really strange about Vadia is that even though they're a very religious and a very political state, they're not on the left and they're not on the right. They will work with communists, they will work with fascists, they will work with anyone who has good enough civil rights and who has a good enough cause. And the people work very hard to make people get along. In fact, they formed what was known as the Triple Crusade. It was a crusade, a jihad, and a Jewish holy war declared all at once via those three powers against everyone else. Specifically satanists, oppressive Christian states, oppressive Muslim states, and oppressive Jewish states. So it's like a... It's a series of wars and conflicts between order and chaos and liberty versus oppression. And Vadi will fight any dictatorship and they will fight any anarchist group. That's just how it works for them.
Interesting, because anarchy just means a world without rulers, not a world without rules.
I know.
Anarchy isn't like the big chaos free-for-all that that people think it is. As a matter of fact, all the things that they fear might come out of anarchy have already come out of the state. State is decided. Which is, yep. Like, it's just this ironic oxymoron.
Yeah, I'm aware of that. So basically the whole setting's like really violent, it's really, really dark. And the people know that they won't be able to fix all the world's problems right away, but they know that if they give every single second of breath they have, they'll eventually be able to do it. And they believe that a single second they spend waiting is a second that somebody else is starving or they're being beaten or something. So it's a really interesting setting. And I've invented a lot of different militia groups, like upper left corner. That's a protecting it. They get surplus equipment. Upper right corner is a militia group. They are revolting against several different countries. They are kind of a neutral power. They're not with us or against us. Those are the moralists. They're like libertarians, but they are for the environment. They're kind of reactionary. They want things to be the way they used to be. And the way things used to be was they had parks, and society was very capitalist, and in the countries they exist, society has become very governmental capitalist. It's become like a state capitalism, but also the environment's been really affected. So they're basically mostly older people that are reacting to all this change. And then the National Defenders, they're like the National Guard for Vadia. That's a mold. It's for different camo colors. I have two different brands of camo I invented myself. They're basically versions of NATO Woodland. And then, you know, the rest of them are just terrorist groups, militias, uniforms, ammo, camo colors. And I just do a little bit of everything. These are the Draxians. They were a people that used to enslave other people in the setting that I got involved in. But when the player quit, the country basically turned into anarchy, and eight different countries fought over the land. This is one of the groups that survived. They're controlled by some warlord. So that's basically like the whole setting. That's kind of my thing. Is that I like to see very ugly things twisted into beautiful things. So that's just me. I don't know if people understand that or not. Is your shirt okay?
Yeah.
So, basically, like, the military shooting Obama for treason, that's turning a very ugly thing into a very beautiful thing.
That's debatable.
Oh, come on, Richard.
But Vadi does have a policy that if the emperor ever does become corrupted or ever does lose the will of the people, he will be executed on sight. Even though he's the most powerful person in the world and his word is basically law. That's basically how
this
is run.
We had that frickin' policy. Technically we do, just nobody's following it.
The way it's set up is the state watches the people and the people watch the state. So for every single camera that's pointed at people by the government, there's two cameras pointed by the people at the state. And the people who actually watch the people and tap all their phones, they are being watched by other people who are being watched by other people who upload what they do to live stream so that everyone can see it. So it's a series of people watching each other.
Sounds like a candid camera on steroids.
Yeah, I mean, you know, that I wouldn't mind. It's like, one thing I've always said is that, you know, all these cameras that are on the streets, the only thing that I mind about them is that it's not a transparent, publicly accessible system. You know, anybody should be able to utilize those, not just government, this, that, and whatever. So I feel that, you know, if the people want to survey themselves, that's fine. Kind of like, you know, that's what social media is. All these different, you know, posts and pictures and videos and stuff to social media, that's the people putting surveillance on themselves. That was actually mentioned on, I do believe, an episode of CSI not too horribly long ago. I think it was one of those shows like that. They were kind of laughing, like, wow, they've made it so easy that people survey themselves.
it's partially because of the paranoia, but it's also out of concern. Because the fact that everything is monitored, it's made it very hard for people to abuse each other. It's also made crime very hard. Actually, the thing that really made, that's for an alternate history setting where the fascist movement was controlled by not the Illuminati, and they became a less racist but still nationalistic power. I've had it's an evil thing turn into a good thing. That's something I do.
I mean, you know, I think the people have the right to survey themselves if they want to. I just think that the government doesn't have the right to survey the people against their will. That's, you know, that's kind of like my standpoint on it. Like, if the people want to do it, then that's their freedom to go ahead and do that if that's what they want to do. But it shouldn't be forced on them by Big Brother. Like, oh, we're going to watch you, you can't watch anything, and fuck you, and this is forced on you. I don't agree with it. But if the people want to survey themselves, I have no problem with that, because then that's the will of the people, that's what the people want to do, and that's their freedom and their right to do it.
Try the bottom mill one. Yeah, the bottom mill one. So, this is back from the 40s in the setting. The group to the right, they're called the Anglos. And the people on the left are the Vadians. The Anglos were an ally, but now they're part of Vadia. That's how the process works. Historically, every single ally that Vadia has ever had has become part of Vadia at one point or another via election or just because they decide to join. Vadia's process of conquest isn't via brute force or via fear. They simply seduce their allies into becoming themselves, and they seduce their enemies into becoming their allies. And when they invade a country, they basically restart society from the bottom up, and they change the whole education system so that the people who are produced by the education system they're their own people, but they're also Vaudians. So when they defeat, you know, Germans or Russians, they're still German or Russian, but they're also Vaudians. The country also has a very, very functioning orphanage system, which produces people who are extremely patriotic because the state takes good care of them. Which is the reason why the last three leaders in both countries have been orphans. Because the people who are produced by the orphans become so patriotic that they basically work really hard in school and they move all the way to the top of the ranks. The reason why everything's named Seth is because Seth was he's the guy who founded DG. He's a martyr that grew up in the system. He was born without parents. His only family was two other people in the orphanage, and he lost both of them, one to cancer and the other one to the wars, and then he founded his own country, and he worked and he worked and he worked, and he trained other people to do their jobs, and he kind of let them do their thing. And then eventually he worked himself so hard that he, like, died.
So basically, it's what patriotism is supposed to be: loyalty to the people, not loyalty to a flag or a corporation or a symbol or a president or whatever, but loyalty to the people of your country.
More or less. There's this whole concept within the religion. It's the religion's kind of based off of Christianity, but it's not quite the same. For example, the Vaudians do not know where the universe came from, and they don't care. It doesn't matter to them. It doesn't affect anything. What they care about is if people are okay. So to them, they have a god, and they're not sure if it's a male or a female or what it is. All they know is, according to their folktale, you ever heard of Prometheus?
Yeah, I've heard of Prometheus.
Prometheus was a titan that gave mankind fire.
Mm-hmm.
That's what they think God is. To them, their god, called the Enlightened One, he is the being that gave them technology. According to their folklore, they were a group of tribes that kind of like lived in dirt and muck, and they fought amongst each other, and they could never go anywhere or do anything. And the first person among them, he was given a flower, and that flower, he ate it, and it infected him with a virus, and the virus warped his brain and his mind and his body, and it made him the first Vaudian. This was thousands of years before Vaudia, though. The people are called the Illumians, after their god, the Enlightened One. The Illumians mean the people who are enlightened.
I know what illumination means in that context.
Yeah. So basically, they basically see God as this being who gave them knowledge, and the knowledge made them who they are. And in exchange, they gave their complete and total loyalty for that knowledge. But the knowledge allowed them to bribe other tribes to join them, allowed them to conquer other tribes, it allowed them to secure their borders, to discover copper, to develop mining technology. All of that knowledge made them a very powerful and strong people. And because of that, they became extremely religious as a kind of payback. So that's kind of how the society warped itself. And every couple hundred years, they have a reform movement where the movement, the religion kind of changes. The old way, the new way, the Seth way. According to the storyline, when Seth died, he went... I create really strange stories. I don't know where I get the ideas for this stuff. But when Seth died, he went to some place like between heaven and hell, according to the story, and he basically sat down with what they call the Dark One and what they call the Enlightened One, and he threatened both of them, and it got into like a little fist fight. And what ended up happening was Seth, because of how bad things had been his entire life, he had actually resented his own god, and he thought the two gods were the same. He thought So the Satan was no different from the devil. He thought they were just people playing chess, and he was one of the stupid pawns caught in the crossfire. And according to the story, God surrendered to him just for no reason. And in the setting, the people are trying to figure out what that even means. They're completely confused what's going on. They don't understand why this happened. Let me put it this way. Seth is Jesus. The people are finally realizing that their God doesn't hate them and actually loves them, and they don't understand what that means, more or less.
It's like, yeah, I don't believe heaven and hell are places. I believe that they are states of being. So whether you're talking about before this life, during this life,
story.
Whatever comes next. I know. I'm just saying my personal beliefs on it. I don't believe in heaven or hell as places or states of being. So whether you're talking about before this life, during this life, or whatever comes next, you know, whatever state you decide to be in based on your belief systems is what you're going to align with. I mean, you know, shit attracts flies, right? If you don't want flies attracted to you, be that which is not attracting flies. So I guess a simpler way of saying that is all action. Well, as my dad might say, he who fucks up gets fucked. I mean, you know, whatever way you want to put it.
The story has a lot of interest. Like, it's kind of science fiction in some areas. Because of nation states, sometimes science fiction does and does not exist, and sometimes fantasy does and does not exist. It depends on who I interact with. But according to the story's lore, when great people die, they kind of go into like this limbo, kind of like what's called purgatory, and they make the decision if they want to go to paradise or if they want to start all over again and struggle more. And great people in the story, they choose to struggle many, many times. For example, Seth has been born two and a half times. And both times he struggled and struggled and suffered, but he built empires from his struggle. And then there are other characters, like Fativ. I create strange names. I use bits of German. I glue them together. And then there was Loki, and there was also Grillia. There's been all these different people, and they've been born over and over again. Every time they're born, they don't remember who they were prior until they're like 20-something, and they struggle, and they struggle, and they struggle. And they build empires. It's kind of a process. So basically, like, all the great leaders that Vadi's ever had are basically the same four people over and over and over again. It's really strange. Another weird thing about the Lumians, the people, is that they don't actually go to heaven. They go somewhere else, typically. They either go to heaven, they go to this place that's kind of like Earth, but it's like 1,000 times worse, and all it is just violence. It's just constant, unearthly violence, and the violence is over what will happen to Earth, but Earth isn't Earth. It's basically like an alternate world where two sides are fighting to invade the real world, but they're always at a stalemate, so neither side can do that. And that's basically where Vadians end up. They either end up there, heaven, or they just go back to the real world all over again.
And if people want to know more about this stuff and interact by actually playing nation states, what web address would they put into their web browser?
I believe it's just nation states. They just type in nation states. It has its own Wikipedia page. And
so .com, .net, .org.
It's .net.
Okay. Nationstates.net.
Here's Vadia. Can I send you the link to Vadia? No. Just for a sec.
Do what?
Can I send you the link to Vadia? Just for a sec.
Yeah, go for it.
Okay. So on the side, I'm in this community. It's called a region. It's like a place. It's like a continent, kind of. And we have our own map and everything. So see that region right there, Aurelia? That's the region. We have our own map. We have our own community. It's mostly full of younger people than me. And I teach them how to fight, and how to role play, and how to tell stories and all that. So I'm a big, I'm a kind of a mentor to them. I teach them how to organize their militaries and how guns work and stuff like that. I have a.
Where do you want me to click?
Oh, you can click on Aurelia if you want.
Here?
Below the flag. Below the flag is the word region. Down. Down. There you go. Aurelia. Now, do you see the word map? It's in green. It's below the word weapons. Okay. Lower your mouse half the screen. Okay. Now, see the green stuff above? Above you.
Oh, yeah, there we go.
Okay, so that's the map. And in the region, you know, we all have responsibilities, we all have problems. So that area right there, that's green, it's next to, it's in the upper right corner, it's next to a purple area called Tom. That's where Ralph is. It's like a protecting, it's like a colony, sort of. And the, these rest of these countries are just other nations I interact with. I teach them how to write and how to do stuff.
So these are chains of islands, apparently.
Yep. Really big islands. Some of them hold 2 billion people. Like, the countries hold 2 billion people. The land masses hold, like, 10. So they're very big land masses, and people fight over them a lot. But they're still learning how to do that. So if you go back, I'm also doing a weapons depot, weapons expo. It's at the very top of the Aurelia region page. So the previous one. You sit back, I guess. Mm-hmm. Yeah. At the top of the page, below, the first thing at the world factbook entry, welcome, there you go, the expo. That's where I am kind of trying to get the community to work together. So this is the like the sign-up place where people fill out a little thing. And it has fine print saying, I will not shoot other people at the expo. I will not mug people at the expo. Because I had to do that. Half these countries are actually, they actually hate each other. Some of them are from outside the region. We have a lot of people from outside the region trying to sell stuff at the expo. Dakin, he's from the region. I'm from the region. Tomarian Reich, he's from the region. Tomarian Reich is actually a very bad nation, but I'm hoping that we can broker peace by working together. Verdi is actually a very close friend of mine. He's right next door. We share everything, pretty much, except the guy who runs the nation's really busy. There's Williamsburg. He runs CATO. It's the biggest alliance. It's like NATO, but way bigger and way less organized. So people have no idea what they're doing. It's like a new alliance. And then T-Reich is he's part of the Grand Alliance, and they're like a bunch of fascist countries with huge militaries. Winter, whatever, he's new. He's kind of like Canada. He's kind of neutral to it all. But he's still interested in being around. That's an outside power trying to sell stuff. That's Catholic Polish Union. He's part of CATO, but he's too fascist to be part of CATO. I think he should get kicked out. So that's basically what I do. I teach people how to write. I tell stories. I create factions. I propose ideas and all that. For the region, I'm officially in charge of RP for the most part. I'm also in charge of keeping the community active and make sure everyone talks to each other. So whenever the community stops having fun and talking to each other, I create something to talk about. That's what I do. And all the countries who have their militaries organized, I help them do that. So that's me. I'm the guy. I'm the this is how your military works kind of guy. Are you in another region? I think you're in another region. Yeah, you're in the world. You're in the world, yeah.
Yes, I am.
Yep. So Nation's just like a really big place, and it has like a lot of anything can happen. It's a place where anything can happen, but within certain limits. For example, the biggest arms company in nation states, Richard, have you heard of Lyris? Lyris Arms?
Lyris Arms.
Mm-hmm. You heard of them?
No.
They're like the biggest arms company in all of nation states. Lyris Arms has 10 billion people, half of them make weapons, and the other half of them are soldiers. And that is mathematically impossible, except Lyris makes insane amounts of money every single day. I mean, every single day. There's like 100 players that order weapons from them every single day, and they spend billions of dollars all the time. Lyris just rakes in money hand over fist, and they use it to build more weapons and have a huge military.
So is this the full nation states map?
No, this is just the map of the region that you clicked on.
No, that's just one region out of many. That's the full nation states map is like...
It wouldn't even fit
on a planet. I think it would be like planets. I think that's the more accurate way of putting it. That's the way I compose my nation, because it's like, okay, it's... You got, like, millions of people on this thing. There's no way you could have a world map that could fit every single nation.
Yeah. What typically ends up happening is that in my setting, I picture the planet they're on as being, like, the size of Jupiter or bigger. Don't ask me how that works. It just does.
It's physically impossible.
Because if I didn't do that, if I had to make like a single Earth-sized setting, I wouldn't be able to interact with as many people, and I like interacting with lots of different nations. And also, players quit all the time, so you need a big place to be able to constantly interact with new people, because old people will give up.
Unless it's like a higher vibratory frequency reality where matter's more malleable, so it would be able to... withstand higher levels of gravity without, like, literally flattening everything into nothing.
Pretty much. And, so it's a really big world, and there's a lot of different countries that interact with each other, and each of them is, like, the size of China when it comes to population. Like, I have 2 billion people in 2 separate nations, which I can legally do because my first nation has 8 billion people, so I just half it, and I split it amongst 2 nations. So you'll have... Like, there's only 7 or 8 billion people in the real world, and I have 4. So that just tells you how big nation states can be.
7 point something in the real world.
Yeah,
I have 3.438 billion people within my nation, just my nation.
Shouldn't you RP it so you have more because you're in the future? You can do that. You can legally do that.
Mm.
The rules, according to the community... are that's your population for MT. You can go down, but you can't go up. But in FT, because you control entire planets, you're allowed to go way higher. You just can't have more than 3 planets when you start off. And if you get more planets, then you have to conquer them from other people and things like that. I'm okay with that. I have three planets in FT as well. According to the storyline, the Illumians, they have a past, which I RP'd, and they have a future, which I RP'd. But I prefer MT because FT... is either full of science, which I'm bad at, or it's full of imagination, and I need to be in, like, a box. Like, I can't have ships that are invincible, that have, like, a million cannons. My brain cannot understand that. I need things to be hard. Which is why all my designs are kit bashes. I take something broken, I try to make it work. I can do that. But what I can't do is I can't design a spaceship and make it, like, I can't do the whole Star Trek thing, but I can't do the whole, like, perfect physics and science thing. So, yeah. Basically, when I write for FT, I get too OCD, so I can't do it.
You know, Tim, you might want to make a nation states page on TSU, or SU as it's called. It's actually social media that pays you for using it. Simply put, you know how, like, social media sites like Facebook, etc., they have ads and they bring in revenue from those ads?
It's a scam.
Well, no, it's not. They keep, Facebook and all that keeps all that revenue.
Not saying Facebook's a scam.
Oh, okay. Whereas TSU, they give 90% of the revenue to their user base, and the 10% that they keep, they invest in more lucrative markets to get greater returns. The profits from that, they put back into TSU to keep expanding it. So, of course, more people join TSU, which means that 10% is obviously bigger than it was before, because more people. Then they take that, invest that into bigger, more lucrative markets, so on and so on. So, you know, the more you post stuff and get stuff shared and the more people you have signed up under you, you know, the more of that chunk is yours. So now imagine if, like, these big superstars that, you know, are on Facebook, you know, imagine if, you know, these people that got, like, you know, 10 million likes and shit, imagine if they were on TSU. They'd be raking in approximately, they did figures on this at one point, I'd have to find it again, but something like a major, like, popular celeb could make something like $2.8 million yearly on TSU, because they've got the demographic for that.
One question. Okay, it says please enter a member short code to sign up. How do you? Well, what?
Hold on. I'll get you there. I'll have you sign up under Richard. So here's General Tate here. So for the short code, you're just going to put in General Tate.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, that should work. I don't know if, like, it's...
Oh, okay, it worked.
Okay, I didn't know if it was, like, case-sensitive or whatever, but... Okay, yeah. So now, you signing up under him, here, check this out. Family tree. I've got 31 children, people under you refer to as children, and 486 total in my overall network. So, like, if I view descendants under Richard Hamilton, we have Brianna, we have Mike Brown, and we have James. I think you know both Mike and James. Mike is, like, how do you say his frickin' thing, Rich?
Bagheera
3005. And James is Tankus.
Tank 50 U.S.
Whatever. So anyway, you probably already know those two people, do you not, Tim?
No.
Oh, okay. They're, and all these people are on DeviantArt, so.
I mean, I know a lot of people, but, like...
Surprised you haven't seen Bagheera 3005. He posts, like, shitloads of cool stuff.
Maybe I have, I just don't remember. But yeah, that's kind of weird, because when I was in high school, I knew everybody. I knew the people who did drugs. I knew the people who, you know, were preppy.
Mike is an engineer in real life, so he likes taking his real life skills and applying it to art. Then he makes all sorts of interesting stuff.
I need to keep good pictures of myself on my desktop for things like this. Okay, I'm gonna download a picture of myself from Facebook. I'm gonna move it over. Okay. Yeah. So, did you know that, like, Facebook, they'll take the pictures of you put on Facebook, and they'll, like, use them in advertising. I'm serious. Like your vacation photos on Facebook.
No, look, there you are. See where it says Timothy Semel. You didn't actually have. If you wanted to, you didn't have to have. You know, Timothy as your name. You could have phrases like, you know, Nation States TSU page. Or,
I put down Gaudius. So I don't know what happened.
You could change it later. You should be able to change it later. That shouldn't be a problem. So I'm going to follow you and add you as a friend. So you'll get those notifications like up in here. See where I clicked on mine?
Yeah. That's a good rap song. You're gonna make me lose my mind up in here. I'm very, I'm a cultural mixer, so, like, I listen to, like, everything.
Yeah, I pretty much like a little bit of everything, too.
Well, I mean, I'm very specific about my taste. Like, my tastes mostly revolve around, like, AC/DC, which it's called speed metal or power metal. It's like, yeah, kind of music. And then the other kind of music I like is called nu metal. It's basically rap with guitars. It's like angry white people rap with guitars. So it's like heavy metal, but like the words are like rap. And it's like basically Linkin Park. You heard of Linkin Park?
Yeah, of course.
Limp Bizkit, Korn, they're all nu metal.
Obviously, I've heard of all of those.
Keep moving on. My brain's ticking like a bomb.
Okay, if you can see the screen here and check this out, this is basically how TSU divides the dollar.
Okay, one second. I'm trying to move. I downloaded a picture of myself, and now I'm going to upload it as my profile.
I mean, this is definitely like a long haul kind of thing, so it's not for the impatient. Obviously, it takes time to grow a demographic, but it's easy. As long as you keep making posts, people will keep liking your stuff, sharing your stuff, following you, adding you to friends, so on and so forth.
Dude,
I have
no likes on YouTube. I know how this works, dude.
Yeah, I'm just saying, I look at it this way, you know. I figure you probably got to have about 500,000 followers in order to make any real money worth mentioning on the system. So I figure it this way. Even if it takes me 10 years to get to that point, the 10 years are going to pass anyway. So how would I rather, you know, spend the time building my demographic or bitching 10 years later that I'm still at the same place that I was 10 years before? You know what I mean?
Dude, I have $27. I have $27 in my pocket. So,
I'm happy. Like for people that have like this, you know, this societal delusion that being successful on social networking requires tons of time and effort and struggle and this and this and this. I've kind of designed something to debunk that. I call it the TSU challenge. Basically, it takes an average of 5 seconds to post one thing on TSU. So the TSU challenge is take 5 seconds out of every 24 hours, post one thing every day, and anybody who says, oh, I don't have 5 seconds out of every 24 hours, I'm pretty much going to call them a liar. The average time on the fucking toilet takes 2 minutes or more. So it's like, while you're on the toilet, whip out your mobile device and post something on TSU. You have the freaking time. Right now, my TSU challenge has just kind of been verbal in conversation. I really should make, like, a little art graphic or something and, like, put that out there. Like, yeah, take the TSU challenge. 5 seconds every 24 hours. If you tell me you don't have that, you are a liar. You know, essentially. So then I get people, you know, that way to realize that if they are not taking that 5 seconds every 24 hours, then that is a choice, and it's their right to that choice. But now they can't like pass the buck off to other excuses. Now they have to face the fact that, okay, I'm making a choice. So it's kind of like my little intention to kind of use that to eliminate the blame game and the passing of the buck syndrome that people have. You know, it's just like, look, if you're gonna make a choice, fine. That's your right to make that choice. That's all well and cool, but you know, let's be honest about what it is. It's a choice. Yeah. I kind of love calling out the elephant in the room, you know?
Do 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 do. Okay, so what I put down my relationships, cohabitable, it's complicated, I don't want to say. I'm going to put down it's complicated. It's very complicated.
Yeah, it's complicated. That works. From what you were describing to me, it sounds complicated enough, so that sounds accurate.
Oh, it's really complicated. Oh my gosh, it's so complicated. Nothing makes any sense.
Yeah, so who's the lucky guy? Just kidding.
It's a spiraling ball of anarchy. Nothing makes any sense. I can't sing at all. I try to sing, but I can't.
I can actually sing pretty good.
That's how I get women to like me. Don't know why it works. It just does.
Her name is Rio, and she dances on the sand. I have a pretty decent voice. Or so they tell me.
So, this is really funny, but like TSU is asking me to add Facebook, but Facebook doesn't want to be added.
Yeah, really, because Facebook has blocked TSU, that's why.
Oh, they're afraid of a little bit of competition, aren't they?
Yes, they are, damn straight.
Well, that's sad. Isn't that the whole point of capitalism or whatever?
Well, Zuckerberg's a control freak, so there's the problem.
Well, this is what happens when you form your website as a prototype for the whole, what was it, was it Hot or Not or something like that? Did you see the movie? Because I saw the movie. And the movie wasn't 100% correct, but it was
I've never seen the movie. It's been one that I've been, you know, considering getting around to eventually, but I've not actually seen it, no.
I'm going to accept you guys as friends because we're pals. That's how this works. Oh, you have a good background, Richard. Is that Marpat? Is it Marine camo? Did Richard die? Richard, are you dead?
He seems to be there in theory. Rich, can you say something? Rich, hello?
Huh?
He might be having technical difficulties. Oh, there you are. Welcome back. He was asking you a question, Rich.
Oh.
Is the cover thing for your TSU account, is that Marpat?
Yes.
Okay, that's what I thought.
Yep.
Yeah.
Good stuff.
And Tim, if you look at the screen here, I have two videos that, or I think actually technically three.
I saw the one where they get around to Facebook. I saw that one.
Yeah. Is Facebook waging war against TSU?
Yes.
How users can get around Facebook's cock block, and one just for fun, Hitler hates TSU. I mean, obviously you're familiar with downfall parodies, right?
Yeah, downfall parodies are hilarious.
Yeah, so I made a TSU downfall parody. Have you seen it yet?
It's funny, I'm watching a downfall parody right now. Hitler plays Fagel Station 4.
I've seen that one already. That's fucking funny as shit.
Yeah.
Have you seen Hitler Hates TSU yet, Tim?
No.
Okay,
I think I saw the Get Around one, though.
I can play that if you want. It's funny. Obviously, because it's all subtitles anyway, the audio is pretty well irrelevant, so it doesn't matter whether or not people can hear it really well or not. But I'm going to fast forward through the intro.
Look inward at heart.
Which invites you to be beautiful. Okay, here we go. I think you'll enjoy this.
Oh wow, this is making it lag. Oh my gosh. Okay, it works now.
Sie hat den Gegner zossen genommen und stößt auf Stahlstoffe. Der Feind auf.
Oh, it's lagging. It is lagging so hard. This is my baby girl, 1-1-2-5-5-2-9. Richard?
Yep.
Did I screw something up?
No, you didn't screw anything up. That's Dave Zind. He's having issues right now. Obviously, he dropped out. It happens. We've had it happen before. In fact, we had it happen with the last guy we had on, RPM Kid on DA. He same thing, mid-technical difficulty.
Really?
Yep. Means we'll probably have to start the hangout and pick up where we left off. knowing how this is going. But of course, it says we're still live, so I'm not sure.
I'm really confused, too. What is Fickle Station for, anyways?
It's a period.
Okay, that was fucked. But I lost internet for a moment. But thankfully, I came back in enough time that we're still broadcasting. Thankfully, it didn't, like, expire and go, nope, sorry, fuck you. We're ending the broadcast now because the host has disappeared.
I like that. The host completely disappeared and we're still broadcasting.
Yeah, temporarily. It gives you a limited amount of time. Oh, and Breanna is messaging me on Skype. One second. Hey, you
back Linux now. Is weird. This is like the strangest... This is the strangest... What am I looking at? Is this what Skype looks like for you?
Yeah.
Are you on Mars or something? This is the weirdest thing I've ever seen.
I'm running Linux. It looks different. Just deal with it.
Linux is... It's like I'm staring into the eyes of God. Except it's Linux. Oh, I'm so funny. Except I'm not. Is she going to join us? Is the famous person...
Hopefully so. Hold on.
Yeah, I just sent the link to her on mine, too.
So. I'm going
to
be right back. I'm going to grab a huge bag of broccoli. I'm going to eat half of it.
Last spot it was at was where the map was, where he's pointing to the map and all that shit. Pretty much the beginning.
Yeah. Sorry, everyone, about the technical difficulties. Okay, looks like Tim is back, so I'm going to resume this, and, you know, hopefully it won't shit out this time.
This is so good.
Süden hat der Gegner Zossen genommen und stößt auf Stahnsdorf vor. Der Feind operiert jetzt am nördlichen Stadtrand zwischen Frohnau und Pankow. In dem Osten ist der Feind bis zur Linie Lichtenberg-Malsdorf-Karlshorst gelangt.
Mit dem Angriff Steiners wird das alles in Ordnung haben.
Can you read it okay, Tim?
Yeah.
Okay, just making sure.
Mein Führer. Steiner konnte nicht genügend Kräfte für einen Angriff massieren. Der Angriff Steiner ist nicht erfolgt.
Yeah, the volume is pretty well irrelevant. This may or may not third-party match because I'm displaying this, but I don't give a shit. At least I know it's not going to get me DMCA'd.
It's your own content.
No, you're not understanding. Downfall is owned by the people who made Downfall. They have it in the third-party matching system.
Right now, but if they're going to block something, they're going to block the original video, not you showing the video.
You're not understanding how this works. I've experienced this already. Trust me, I understand how this works, and I have experienced this already. Trust me.
Well, then it's weird.
May or may not. No, not at all, because I understand how their content matching system works. So no, it's actually not weird when you understand how the system works.
It's weird from my perspective.
Fair enough.
Yeah, my wife insists that I eat food regularly.
Okay. Now it seems to be streaming okay, so we'll just begin it from there. Third time's a charming.
We saw the part where everybody leaves the room.
Yeah, just read.
Hi.
Hello.
Brianna, you there?
Oh no, she's dead.
I don't think she's there.
Oh no. I'm having too much fun. This should be illegal. It's totally the broccoli.
First yet again, I don't know what her connection is right now, so...
Y'all could read this, right?
Yeah, I can read everything.
Just checking.
This is an outrage.
Rampage! This was supposed to strike fear into their hearts. I long for the good old days when the iron-fisted tyranny was respected as strength, not made a mockery
like an episode of The Simpsons. It's all butthurt. Sebastian should be dead of a brain aneurysm. Yeah, no, it's...
I never knew this done as Homer Simpson. Yes, but that's not the point! He's the CEO of Facebook!
John?
I think Brianna's there.
She's not moving.
Hey!
Okay, she is moving.
Hi. I'm just sitting still.
We're watching a downfall parody at the moment about, you know, Facebook censoring TSU and all that. I haven't seen you back on TSU in forever, Brianna. What happened to you?
When I got my new phone, I didn't download all of the apps that I had, so TSU has not made it onto my new phone yet.
Hopefully that'll change.
We'll get there.
Yeah, unless you have an aversion to making money and stuff, unless you're, like, allergic to it.
Very funny.
Oh, and the cool thing is that the CEO of TSU, Sebastian Zubcheck, not only is he following me on TSU, but he's also got me added on Facebook. So you got to figure Zuckerberg's probably stalking his page. So I post this kind of shit right on Sebastian's page so Zuckerberg can see it. I'm broadcasting live right now. Is there... Oh, okay. Someone wanted to talk to me.
Can somebody introduce me to her? Introduce her to me? Because I have no idea who she is.
Brianna?
Yeah.
Brianna, Tim. Tim, Brianna.
One second.
Hello.
All right, I live in a cave. Everything's so dark in here. There you go. I'm gonna line shit. Now I'm seeing my phone.
Yeah. Are you still watching this, Tim, or...
I already saw it all.
When did you already see it all? It's still playing.
Oh, it's still playing? I thought it was done.
No, it's not done.
Okay, well, in this moment, I'm an idiot.
Oh, it's okay to say you don't really give a shit about watching it. That doesn't make sense.
Yeah. So how do you know her?
I'm Richard's friend. We went to school together.
Oh, so you're school chums. Chums as in like buddies?
Yes.
School as in school? Yeah. Every time I use the word school chums, everybody gives me a weird look like I'm a freaking person speaking Arabic or something. So I'm just some guy that,
he's some guy that neither of us really technically know from DeviantArt, and for most of this hangout, we've been featuring his art and talking about his art.
And TSU. You
know, and he just made a TSU account, so we're kind of showing that, and then he was like, why won't it let me add Facebook into TSU? It's like, oh, because Zuckerberg's just a whiny bitch and jealous of competition. And so that led us into the downfall parody we were just watching, Hitler Hates TSU, that, you know, I made that parody to just basically make it out you know, so Zuckerberg's just being a whiny bitch, and him and Hitler are in alliance as gay lovers trying to work together.
Oh my god!
See, that's part of what you missed when you kind of, like, had your little, like, ADHD moment. Yeah. The gay lovers part was kind of coming in. But, yeah, you missed it.
I watched most of that video you posted on Facebook.
Oh, I think so cool.
Where did Rich go?
No idea.
Well, he keeps dying and rising from the dead like a zombie, so...
It's like he's here, then he's not here, then he's here, then he's not here, then he's here, then he's not here.
Maybe he's like one of those people from another dimension, and he like has to go back to their dimension and like turn the machine back on to come back. That's so Star Trek.
Dimension coming quarter.
Yes, I own a Busby shotgun. I blame my siblings. It is their fault. When you're the oldest of four people, you will never stop being a kid. There is nothing I can do about that. I will always be like a 10-year-old inside.
Common core math: 2 + 6 equals turtle because aliens.
Exactly.
Actually, I'm technically an education major, and I was doing several teaching classes when that shift happened. And from what I remember.
We can remove the F from that one.
What do I remember? Oh, yeah. I was explaining this to someone in a history class, and I said, when Common Core happened, we knew that the current system we had in place was crap, but we had no idea if the new system would be better or worse. So there was a bunch of people who said, Jesus is coming down! We are saved! It is our salvation! And then the other half was saying, oh, no! It's the end of the world! We're all gonna die! And then I was like,
yeah, this chick,
oh, wait, those
this
are the
chick Allison that I know on Facebook is a public school teacher, and her opinion of Common Core is that it's about as engaging as having your eye poked out with a pencil.
But the old system was like that.
No, the new system
worked.
Way
worse.
At
least in the old system, they said that 2 + 2 = 4. Now it's like 2 + 2 = elephant because aliens. You know, that's the new system. Everybody's. Yep. I mean, when you've got parents completely outraged about the new system, teachers and parents are allied with each other about
What's
that
up?
Outrage, that's when you know it's really bad.
Oh. No, it's not a problem at all. What do you want to do? Yeah, then let's just do our thing. I mean, it's just rain. Yeah. Okay. Roger that. Okay, so I gotta go in 5 minutes. I had to reschedule, actually. We're gonna do that an hour ago. I have to go over to the stair chain and get all my stuff. And then I'm gonna help my dad throw all the stuff he's got, because he's gotta burn the past, and I gotta get my past back. That's my stuff. I got books on, like, the Soviet Union that I want back. That's my stuff. So, yes.
Me, Breanna, and Rich can continue when you leave and talk about whatever and then, you know, finish out the hangout. Whenever Rich comes back from being abducted by Common Core alien elephants, I'm not quite sure what it means.
The education system is really strange because every time there's a reform, the system gets better but also gets worse at the same time. It's very hard to tell if the new system is better or worse than the old system.
It gets more efficient at screwing us over, so in that way it gets better.
Because like the first reform happened in like the 80s. When that reform happened, certain people performed really good and certain people performed worse. Yeah. So I think it was like certain communities of poor people performed better and certain communities of poor people performed worse. And it like depended on all these weird things that were hard to understand.
Extensively into Common Core and talked to a great many people, ranging from students to parents to teachers, and they all wish Common Core had a neck so that they can choke it to death. That's the concern.
Yeah.
I mean, when you have parents, students, and teachers all agreeing with each other, when usually they all disagree with each other on almost everything.
Well, that's how they thought about the old system.
They're all agreeing with each other on this. Then, I mean, look at Common Core math sometime. It's fucking ridiculous.
I already looked at it. It's really strange, but it was a little more organized. Okay, let me put it this way. Common Core provides a certain degree of structure, which I did not have in elementary school, which got me fucked over. Because the teachers had no idea what to teach for third grade math. They had no idea. Multiplication, division, powers, they had no idea.
Ridiculousness, then sure.
So it's going to depend. There's going to be teachers who are like really good at teaching, and they're going to be really pissed off because they have to do a new method. They can't do their thing, they have to do someone else's thing. And there's going to be really awful teachers who suck at teaching, and now they're going to have a method now, and a process, so they'll probably teach better. But it's going to be years before we figure out what this whole thing will do.
Oh, no, it's not going to be years. I think we've already got it figured out pretty well, unfortunately.
I mean, in the 50s, there was a huge Red Scare, but communism wasn't even a problem in the U.S. It was just hysteria. So,
only a problem in the U.S. now.
You can't tell.
We have as a president, for fuck's sake.
You can't tell if it's hysteria or not until you've had time to, like, look back at it.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I totally have to do something here. Here we go. Short little, like, 5-second video or so. The effects of Common Core. Yes, this is the effects of Common Core right here. Here we are. Oh, what?
I don't know.
That sums it up right there.
I feel the same way about Common Core that I do about the political debate. I feel like when people complain, Common Core is a bad system, but I'm not sure what it could be replaced with.
The old system?
How about we replace both systems with common sense? Oh wait, that doesn't exist anymore.
Actually, common sense is sometimes bullshit.
There's no such thing as common sense, because common sense isn't common, unfortunately.
Well, yeah, but also because common sense can be wrong.
It's an oxymoron.
Like there was a moment in time where people were like, black people are idiots. Common sense. Yeah, that's problem not common sense.
That's a social belief.
If you think racism is sensible, which I don't, but
like, can you prove common sense is common, and can you prove it's sense? Because the masses aren't exactly smart people.
The people with white shirts are right, and the people with black shirts are bad. That's racism, pretty much.
I think a better word in place of common sense would be more like basic logic.
Critical thinking?
Yes, because that remains the same, but common sense shifts. Common sense goes one way, then the other, and like, I've seen people...
I think you should hear a different definition of it.
Well, I don't know. I mean, it's weird, because it's a word, so it's controlled by what people think it means.
Yeah, here's the common definition now of critical thinking. The standard definition of critical thinking is shut the fuck up, obey, and do as you're told. That's what a lot of people kind of think critical thinking is. That's not what it is, because they've eliminated both the critical and the thinking out of the entire process.
It's a good thing I'm in college, because when I was going to get into college, they're all like, "It's a hotbed of communism. Oh my gosh." I got into college, I'm like, well, it's there. You know, there's the social justice warriors and all that, but, you know, you can almost ignore them. They're kind of like those crazy people.
Yeah, like, he's thinking of my graphic that I made. Have you seen my little graphic making fun of social justice warriors?
They're kind
of
like those homeless people.
Hold on, Dave, I'll find it. I'll find it.
All right, you find it and engage your screen share.
There's like a radio shop by my house, and across the street from it is like these 8 black guys, and they like threaten anyone white they see, and they all insist they're like Israeli. They're kind of, that's what social justice warriors are for me. They're just people I think are crazy. I don't take them seriously. I don't think they're a threat. They're too crazy to be a threat. Homeless people are not dangerous. They get arrested all the time.
I smoke tobacco at the pipe. It means I'm homeless.
They're just people that walk around and mumble things. Look at my shoes on. Oh my gosh, it is raining. You see, in Phoenix, Arizona, we worship rain. Most of us are extremely devout people.
You're in
there's
Phoenix?
God, and then there's the rain god, and they have equal power in our lives.
Hold on, you're in Phoenix?
Yeah.
Then Daphne Dugan is freaking local to you. You guys could show up on a PSEC hangout together in the same freaking room.
Well, the weird thing is that it's raining really hard here. In Arizona, it's either super sunny or it rains for like 8 hours in a row or something crazy. So it's either we're either being flooded or we're all like without water for like months. There's like no water for months, and it floods over and over and over again, and there's no water for months.
Yeah, Jay Larson's local to you too. Hey, Rich, you know what needs to happen one of these days? We need to have a PSEC hangout where you and Breanna are in the same room. And Kim, Jay, and Daphne are in the same room on the same screen. And then, like, me, Katarina, and Isabella are like, in the same room on the same screen. That would be, like, yeah. Well,
that would be a lot of people.
I live in a shitty state, but it's my shitty state. Do-do-do-do-do.
What do you think?
We are 47 in education, and we are 47 in funding.
Hey, what do you think, Rich? You think that'd be a cool idea?
Yeah. I mean, if you can get Isabel Rizzo to talk to you.
I'm not sure if I want these people in the same room as me.
Why?
Oh, they're cool.
Because when I meet people, there's like two outcomes. Either they want to kill me on sight or they want to marry me. It's like really weird.
Oh, believe me, you're not going to have that outcome. Jay is non-judgmental in any and all directions. He's just like whatever, people are who they are. And Daphne is already married, so I don't think you need to worry about her wanting to marry you. You're safe. You're completely safe.
That's a huge relief.
Yeah, even if Isabel doesn't show up, it's like, you know, next time Katarina's in Chicago, we could be here. Then Breanna and Rich could be on their side there. And then, you know, you, Daphne, and Jay could be on your side. And if you really, really want to have fun, if, like, the three of you want, like, someone to throw into the wall and beat the shit out of, you guys could always, in person, invite Brian Maldonado. Then you just have someone to, like, shut up! You know.
I don't get the joke. I don't know this guy, so I don't really...
Rich gets the joke. He knows who Brian Maldonado is.
Is he a guy you guys hate, or is he just a guy who, like, is invincible?
Rich doesn't always recognize the name when I say it, but he recognizes him by description.
Oh, the crazy guy. He's like, yeah.
like on the phone with us, and then you were like, fuck this, and you're like, thank God I left before it got real crazy. I'm like, yeah.
Okay. Here it is. Either you are with me, or you are my enemy. My God, Anakin! You've become a PCSJW! Obi-Wan, your racism against the Sith is manifesting the psychological projections of your inferiority complex based on your envy of my superior enlightened viewpoint.
Yeah, so it's like I'm basically calling politically correct social justice warriors frickin', you know, Nazi Sith lords, essentially.
I have a hard time being completely offended by these people, because even though they do stuff that pisses me off,
they're funny.
I can kind of ignore them sometimes. They're kind of like, yeah, they're like homeless people. They're crazy.
They say shit like cutting off your dick will prevent rape. You know, I mean, they say all these like outrageous things. You can't help but laugh. It's really difficult to be offended by these people because they say such ridiculous shit, it's comedy.
Oh, dude, I remember when there was this woman, and she uploaded these huge videos, and I couldn't watch them during school, so like between classes I would read the transcripts, and I read through like three of them, and they made a lot of sense. And I was like, okay, you know, there are moments where guys are kind of screwed over, just like women. And I was very supportive of her, and then there's this one video where she just, like, was completely just nuts. Like, it was terrifying. Yeah. And I was like, oh, great, you're just as bad as the crazy third-wave feminists are.
Video games force men to grow two penises to double rape disempowered females while aliens put in the anal probes. Okay, get off the crack, lady. Just need some help, seriously.
Piss bad for drugs equality! Here. Piss for equality! Bleed for equality!
Yeah, shut up.
Yeah, why not masturbate for equality, too? Being against public masturbation is sexist! You know, it's like cray-cray to the max.
I remember this woman threw this huge fit because she wasn't allowed to be naked in Canada, but Canada already has a law where you're allowed to be naked whenever you want and nobody cares.
Well, who knows? Maybe she was a 500-pound land whale and nobody wanted to look at that, so they arrested her for being an eyesore in public.
No, she wasn't even arrested. She just threw a huge fit about it. I don't know. It happens. Why are you looking at... Why is Richard looking at solar flares?
Because they're all...
Because
awesome.
He is. I'll be right back because I need to take my
massive. Oh God! Was that thunder? Was that a mortar strike?
I need to take my massive thing that is sexist against women because it exists and bring it to the bathroom to inappropriately pee in the toilet when I should be peeing in public or whatever like crazy stupid thing these social justice warriors say that makes no sense. I'll be right back.
Okay, so I don't know if you know this, but like in New York, there's pubs everywhere. And people don't care if you, like, go into an alley and do your business. Nobody cares. Because, you know, bathrooms in pubs aren't very good anyways. And dark alleys are already piles of filth, so nobody cares. Well, this guy in Arizona was doing that. And this woman who had, like a baby in the back seat. She was driving a minivan. She drove by. She stopped her vehicle, stared at him. And what ended up happening was the guy ended up with a sex offender charge. Because... her six-month-year-old saw him doing his thing in the dark alley or whatever. And it was really... Yeah.
Well, people are stupid.
Yeah.
You watched... My six-month-old son watched you take a shit in an alley. That's...
No, he just urinated.
Oh.
Yeah.
Urinating in an alley, that's against the law. You know how many times I've driven down the I-5 corridor, you know, like accidentally took a wrong exit and like there's a car on the side of the road, some woman squatting at the side of the road. It's like, okay, big deal. Yeah, she needs to alleviate, you know, there's not a rest stop every couple of miles. Big deal. I'm not going to report her to the police because she was urinating on the side of the road. You know, big deal.
I mean, we all have siblings, right? You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like I'm the oldest of four. My siblings when they get to like between 2 and 4, they have this stage where they just run around naked and you're like, what are you doing? And put some clothes on. And they're like, wee, I'm naked. And you're like, God, please blind me now. But of course, it never happened because he didn't listen. It didn't happen. So eventually, you get to that point where other people do the same bull crap. When you're over at people's houses and you just don't care, just like kids don't make any sense.
I've just spoken with Admiral Obama, and we have our orders. He has instructed us to stand down and not engage the ISIS fleet.
With respect, sir, but I think it is safe to presume that I speak for the entire crew when I say, to hell with our orders.
I still don't agree with that viewpoint because he did go to Congress and ask if we could invade Syria, and Congress said no.
Well, yeah, and yet again, you can watch the videos of John McCain sitting there saying, oh, we need to fund ISIS. I mean, the rebels, yeah, ISIS, yeah, those guys, yeah, we need to fund them. Yeah, we need to give them weapons. He did that on the news. That's, you know... No, Obama didn't want to go to ISIS or go to Syria. He wanted to go to Syria to take out the al-Assad regime so that way ISIS could then take over the country, destabilize the Middle East as a whole, which is basically what the Russians are preventing, you know, ISIS from doing. You know.
Well, what I would personally like to
see... And number one, the American people don't want us sending boots on the ground. We've already been doing that for enough years as is, and, you know, it doesn't matter if Obama goes to Congress or not. You know, he says, oh, we're invading Syria. He already illegally invaded Libya. He already illegally, you know,
I think Libya wasn't even boots on the ground. That was just cruise missile strikes.
No, they sent boots in. I mean, why were there Marines at some compound if they didn't send boots on the ground? It's just that the mainstream media turned a blind eye when they did it.
Well, it wasn't they sent
like two battalions of Marines in there. You send two battalions of Marines in, you're going to be fucking some shit up and killing some people.
Actually, I think we have two battalions in a lot of places.
I watched the whole thing break out. There were news articles all over the place. From my experience, I saw it firsthand. They sent people in. They
are all racist! That's for no reason! I'm a social justice warrior.
Two battalions is enough to make things happen, but it's not enough to, like, do much
else. Now, Dave, remember, this is a troll-free zone. A troll-free zone manifests a magical force shield that prevents trolls from commenting on this hangout.
Oh, just like gun-free zones.
Or like pot-free zones.
Marijuana-free.
You know, they really make murder illegal so that it stops murder from happening. They really need to get
around. Right? Yeah, seriously.
Yeah.
So, Breanna, how does it feel to be on your very first PSEC hangout?
I'm terrified. Oh, okay. I'm glad you guys aren't asking me to say anything.
Okay. I felt bad.
Why be terrified? You're surrounded by friendly people.
I was worried because we went stop talking and you didn't say anything.
Okay, hold on. This is synchronistic. Here's Al. I was talking about trolls, and now Alex is trolling.
And yes, it's true. I'm an agent of choice yet again. In that I have.
Was Alex?
Early.
Huh?
I think that was Alex.
That is battling for 20.
You can't hear it.
You can barely hear it.
I can barely hear it. Who the hell is this guy? Contact.
Oh, he's just some. He's just randomly speaking. The other day he did something really funny with like this phallic thing, and he's like foaming at the mouth, and he's being all weird and stuff. He was trolling really hard. It was funny. Apparently Facebook lets you do live events now, which I think is interesting. If you can't hear it, there's no point in me playing it continuing further.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So Breanna, how have you been?
I'm good.
No need to be terrified if you don't want to be. You are surrounded by nice, friendly people.
And I know that. It's still scary.
Yeah. But if you presented a project in high school, you can do this.
I can do high school, but
in front of the class and talk to 26 different people all at once.
You're saying you can do
but
things.
I don't care what they think. Cause it's different.
Yeah. So you're saying you can do you can deal with things that are far more tyrannical and intimidating than this. Cool. That means you can do this with no problem.
That's
no. This is more intimidating because I actually care what you guys think.
Well, we already accept you for who you are. So just be yourself. That's all we want.
This is true.
Yeah, they're making really offensive jokes that don't make any sense, and nobody got mad at them. So. And I am filling around with Nerf guns, so nobody got mad at me for filling around with Nerf guns the entire time.
I'm in my hotel room at a gun convention, so.
Cops are going to break down your door, because if you have a Pop-Tart that seems to be shaped like a gun, you get arrested. I know. Cool, the cops come, so you terrorist with your Nerf guns. Shame on you.
Yeah.
Naughty boy.
There's this guy in Canada. His son drew a picture of a gun. And he and his son got arrested.
Fun.
And he got and they interrogated him, and then they searched his house, and they found a water gun. And the entire time,
I guess pimp my gun must be illegal in Canada then.
And the entire time, no. They let him free, but the entire time they were like looking at the house and they were interrogating him. They're interrogating the boys, like, tell us where the guns are. Tell us where Daddy keeps his guns. And It's really weird, because in Canada, I actually seen a video where a guy goes to a gas station in Canada and he buys a TAR, the Israeli rifle. He bought it at a gas station. It was just a big, huge gas station, and part of the gas station was a gun store. And he had his paperwork filled out, and he did the 6 month wait and all that.
There are some guns you can buy in Canada that you can't even buy here in the States.
It's really weird. It is. Like in America, we do this stupid thing where, like, we ban certain stocks because those, like, are weapons now somehow. Like, oh no, he has a military-grade stock. He could kill someone with that.
He could beat him over the head with it like a hammer, so let's ban hammers, too.
I'm trying to ban
hammers. Yeah, we can't build
any. Let's ban matches. Arsonists use them.
Well, what's really funny is, like, you know, I'll use Pimp My Gun as an example here. A gun like this would be considered an SBR. Got to pay a $200 tax for stamp for it. This would be considered a pistol, which you can buy legally. But if you add a stock to it, simply like this, it is now a short-barreled rifle, and you have to get the permit to have a stock with a barrel shorter than 16 inches.
For no apparent reason.
For no apparent reason. And what's really interesting, the same freaking rifle with a 16-inch barrel, you know, you can add all of the different stuff to it. You can, you know, get your stocks here. You can put a paratrooper, the same freaking stock right there. And it's just a folding stock AK. It's no big deal. But, oh, you shrink that barrel down to something like that. Oh, my God, it's a pistol. It's a short-barreled rifle. Oh, boy, you know, you're in trouble.
I think the problem is that people are thinking is they are afraid of, like, really powerful concealable weapons.
You
which
could
is weird.
Not, because... you could not conceal that even if you wanted to, even with a trench coat. It would be sticking. You'd have to literally put it down your pants leg, and then you'd have... be walking past people and they'd be saying either that's a really weird looking thing you've got in your pants or you're having a good time.
Hey, Rich.
You're not going to be able to hide that thing.
Rich, is that your automatic weapon or are you just really happy to see Breanna?
I think the reason why they're worried about the stocks might be because it's really hard to be accurate with out of stock. But on the other hand, I don't think mass shooters really care if they're accurate or not. They just hose into the crowd or whatever. Yeah, you know, they go. No, they don't even need a stock. They just shoot everything.
Here, I'm gonna make this UN periwinkle blue.
Oh, another thing that pisses me off.
Now you can't even conceal it because it's so brightly colored, and I'll be even more illogical. Let's do something really stupid here. Let's put let's do this. Duplicate.
You know,
I love it. It's a extended magazine. How stupid.
I love it when people think that, like, false flag attacks could not possibly involve crazy lone gunman shooters. Like, yeah. As if a government has no ability to take a person who's already crazy, give them a gun, point them at a crowd and say, here, go crazy. You're already crazy. Go do what you already do. Government has no capability to do that. You know, we can nuke the planet, but we can't stick a crazy person in a crowd. That's just physically impossible.
The problem behind the line of thinking is we'll never know if it was planted or not. Because crazy people behave like crazy people, and you'll never know if crazy people were manipulated into being crazy or not.
Well, you don't even have to manipulate them into being crazy. Just take a person that's already crazy and position them like a chess piece. It's like putting the bull in the china shop. You don't have to make the bull into the bull. The bull's already the bull. The china shop is already the china shop. You just have to introduce the bull into the china shop, and then the inevitable happens. Just like there's this one judge, I think it was Judge Napolitano, is that how you say his name? He was on the news going over incidents where, like, the FBI, these are incidents where, that have been proven, the FBI actually placed crazy people in places to do things and then busted them so that they could go, oh, see, we're busting terrorists, but they're the ones who put the nutcase in position in the first place. So we've already got evidence that, yes, this is done. This is, like, on the books as having been done. So, you know, it's like that's already there. I just love people's mentality. It's like, oh, no, the government could never take someone who's already batshit fucking crazy and put them in a crowd. You know, we could nuke half the planet, no problem, but we can't take a crazy person and say, go that way. No, that's just beyond the government's capability. Most powerful government in the world with technology and resources could blow up half the planet, but they could never stick a crazy person in a crowd. No way.
It's too clumsy.
That's exactly the point. They got full plausible deniability that way.
No. But like, what would the point be? Like, what do you get from that?
To incite fear and thus also political agenda. It, like, for example, if you want to push gun bans, you got to make people scared shitless of guns. How do you do that? Give a crazy a gun, put them in a crowd, and let them go crazy with their gun.
But we've government- had like 100 of those. And it hasn't made us hate guns anymore. It's actually made us more entrenched into liking guns. Gun ownership. Exactly.
I'm just telling you how these people think. I'm not claiming that these people think rationally or reasonably or sensibly. They're psychopaths. I'm just explaining how the psychopaths that call themselves government think and what they do. Of course it doesn't make much sense. That's why it always backfires on them. I mean, you know, and again, there's another myth that psychopathic morons could never get into positions of power. Gee, how could that ever happen? Like, Obama can't speak without a teleprompter, and George W. Bush is lucky he was smart enough to be able to tie his own shoes. But of course, we could never have idiots in power. That's no, that could never. Impossible.
But don't it's all like, people yeah. speak with teleprompters? I mean, professors use teleprompters. They write down the speech, and then they just recite their own speech.
They write down their own speech. Obama doesn't speak his own material. He's got a staff to write for him. You ever notice when the teleprompter goes down, and he's like, oh, what do I do? Oh, fuck, teleprompter, it's gone. You know, his own associates have even cracked jokes at Obama, have even said, oh, well, his teleprompter doesn't fail. You know, his own freaking peers have cracked jokes at him about that.
Because those
peers are speaking there without a teleprompter to the crowd.
There was this movie where this guy gets elected, and, like, there's all this stuff that, like, interferes with his political career and all that. But the moment where he gets himself elected is where he admits that, like, he paid some company $400 to tell him how much shoe polish should be on his shoes. Because if there's too much shoe polish, then the poor people won't vote for him. But if there's not enough, then the rich people won't support him either. And he explains how, like, the shirt he wears to all the debate has to be a specific color, otherwise he'll lose voters. And he explains, like, how the whole thing forces him to dress a certain way and behave a certain way just so people will actually listen to him.
Well, it's like Governor Jesse Ventura once said. He said the reason that he was able to do so good in politics is because it works exactly like wrestling. There you go.
I heard there was this guy. I believe he became... Dad's here. I gotta go. See you there, guys.
All right. Catch you later. Thanks for joining us. So, Breanna, how have you been?
I'm good.
Cool. So, what do you think?
I don't know what everyone said
so far.
I said, what
do you think about everything that's been said so far? I mean, other than Common Core, you did put your 2 cents into that. Just like Common Core bit. Rich wasn't here for that, though. I even played the video. You missed that.
I don't know.
Having fun? Despite being, like, partially terrified. Are you having fun? Whoop. And she dropped out. Maybe Google kicked her out like it kept kicking you out? Everybody's been having connection issues lately, have you noticed?
Mm-hmm.
Even I've been having connection issues lately, periodically, as we experienced earlier.
She said, yeah, she did drop out. Yeah, apparently she has to go.
Oh, she does.
Yep.
Okay, well, that was interesting timing then.
Mm-hmm.
You can just thank her for participating and whatever, and that. What? Ah, really?
Mm-hmm.
That's interesting. Yes, welcome to Periodic Technical Difficulties. It's kind of been one of those weeks. I mean, I know several times this week, like, you know, my connection has, like, periodically bombed out for no apparent reason. We've also been having a lot of solar flares and stuff. So anyway, any other thoughts that you want to add to anything and everything that's been discussed on this whole, you know, thing so far? I'm guessing start to wind this down. So kind of like final thoughts.
Yeah, I can't think of anything. I haven't really been participating or paying attention for that matter because I've been busy everywhere else. I've just been kind of partially participating, but, you know, just another good hangout.
Yep. Cool. Alrighty. Well, thank you everybody for watching. Hope you've all enjoyed yourselves, and see you next time, and laters.
See ya.